Hello, hello, and welcome to my channel, AquaRach. Today I'm doing another little illustration as part of my holiday art series. This time it's going to depict a little girl and her mom picking out their Christmas tree. And I've already sketched this out, so all I have to do is transfer it onto my watercolor paper. But first, let me show you the colors I'll be using. Be using a lot of Payne's gray, a little bit of sepia, not really any burnt sienna, Hansa yellow I will be using, and also pearl red. Okay, so I'm going to use my carbon paper right here to transfer my sketch onto my watercolor paper. And I do have a template of this illustration available for you to download, print at home, and that is available to you for free. The link is in the description below. And I'm just using my transfer paper here. It's face down on my watercolor paper and my sketch is on top. And I just have to apply a little bit of pressure to get the carbon to transfer these lines onto my watercolor paper. So this illustration, as I said, it depicts a little girl and her mom. They're picking out a Christmas tree. And the little girl is picking out this really short, small Christmas tree because that's one that she can reach the top of. And she wants to put the star on top of the tree all by herself. And this illustration is really just kind of a memory of mine from when my daughter was younger. And she was probably about, I don't know, maybe six. And that's what she wanted. She wanted the smallest tree that she could find so that she could put the topper on it all by herself. So that's what we did that year. And now she is 16 and she is almost the same height as me. So yeah, it's crazy how fast time flies. So I guess this mom is me, just a skinnier version, a skinnier, younger version of me. And then for the trees, I am kind of using some broken lines to depict the little branches. I don't need them all to be completely connected to the trunk of the tree. I want them to look a little bit natural. And then I'm just going to use some masking tape to tape down my watercolor paper, and I'm ready to get started. So I'm going to start out mostly with just a lot of Payne's gray. I'll even run out of my Payne's gray and have to refill my well because this is my favorite color lately. And for these final illustrations I do as part of this series, I am just going to stick with this general color palette. All of these colors came together in a set from M. Graham, and I really love this color palette for these winter scenes. And I think also because I have been really inspired lately by the artist Anders Zorn, and this color palette kind of just generally reminds me of the Zorn palette, which he is best known for utilizing, a very, very limited palette that was just black, yellow ochre, cadmium red, and then of course white. And so this is kind of similar. Payne's gray is kind of almost kind of a cool black or a cool neutral. And then that pearl red is a very strong red. Now the Hansa yellow isn't really very much like yellow ochre, but it's balanced out by the sepia. Okay, so I put down this kind of light wash of Payne's gray. And then you can see I added a little texture to the background here by just blotting my paper towel onto that wet paint. So I really like that texture. And this illustration isn't going to have like any falling snow or anything like that, but there is going to be snow on the ground. And I'm already having to refill my Payne's gray here. And then I'm going to go in with even more of that while everything is still a little bit damp. Just going to add a little bit of shadow underneath the figures and the trees. And I, of course, do want to keep this mostly light down here because there's going to be snow on the ground. But I want to add a little bit of texture. And the only places I really need to be terribly careful about is just painting around the figures and also around these trees that are a little bit more in the foreground. So we have two trees depicted in here right now. The one on the left is kind of a larger tree. And then the small one, of course, is the tree that the little girl is picking out. And I'm going to handle those a little bit differently than I've handled trees before. And we are also going to have some distant background trees just to give a little bit better texture and framing to this composition as well. So now I'm going to start working on the faces. There's not very much skin showing in this illustration. It's really just the faces. So I am using my Pearl Red and my Hansa Yellow just to mix a nice light kind of peachy color. And I'm going to test it over here on this scrap paper. I want to keep it pretty light and watery because especially on the little girl's face, because you can see quite a bit of her face, I do want to drop in a little bit of red to give her some rosy cheeks. So on the mom right here, we don't see much of her face, so I won't have to, I might add a little bit of red to her nose, but that is it. And this is looking very, very orange right now. So what I did was I just kind of blotted my paintbrush onto my paper towel, and then I used those dryer bristles just to pick up a little bit of the pigment from the little girl's face. And while she's still wet, I'm just going to drop little bits of red onto her cheeks and her nose. And the red, at least right now, it might look a little bit intense if you're able to kind of see that. But as it dries, it'll become a little bit less intense. And I don't worry too much about, you know, if it starts kind of moving all over her face. I have found that not trying to control that too much and just kind of letting the watercolor do what it's going to do, I usually end up liking the result. So I would say even though it's tempting to really try to control, especially on the faces of people, just kind of let it go and see how it ends up. Now I'm going to paint her coat red because I kind of want her to be the focal point of this painting. And that's one thing also I really like about this palette is that you get such a nice contrast between all these more subdued colors in the palette, and then the red is really meant to be kind of the spot color that draws the eye. And for the mom right now, she's mostly going to have a lot of Payne's gray on her, but I will go and glaze over different parts of her clothes with other colors just to give her a little bit more interest and help her stand out from the background. But she's really not the focal point of this painting. And for her coat, I kind of want it to be gray. So I'm using my sepia and my Payne's gray to kind of just create a warmer gray for her coat. And a little bit later in the painting, I'm actually going to be using some white ink to help her coat look a little bit more light gray. I did a lot of experimenting in this piece, and so I'm going to be slowing down the video every time I do something a little bit more experimental. But for the most part, it's kind of just the challenge of using a very limited palette to add different areas of interest to this composition and just kind of learning how to use intensity of your color and also value to help create focal points and interest and variation throughout the composition. So I'm just adding a little bit of dry brush to the mom's coat just to give it a little bit of texture and definition. And then her boots, I'm just going to go in with some really dark Payne's gray here. So you can see that she's almost starting to blend into the background, and that is going to get a little bit worse before it gets better. But that's okay. It all worked out in the end. And now I am going to be using this Payne's gray here to start adding a little bit of volume to the trees. So basically what I'm going to do is kind of use some big loose strokes just around the little branches that I drew in. At this point, there's going to be a lot of white showing through. But I want the trees not to look, you know, spiky or sharp. And so what I'm doing is I'm really pressing down with my brush so that I get a little bit more of a rounded or oval stroke. And I'm focusing more on the ends of the branches right now, leaving the center of the tree a little bit more white. And the idea of this is basically just that I want these trees to be lighter in value than the background trees that I will be putting in fairly soon. So I'm leaving a lot more white than I really want in there in the end, but it's all for the purpose of just making sure that I have enough of a difference in value between these two trees and then the background trees. So just kind of playing it safe and leaving in more white than I necessarily need. Because with watercolor, it's a lot easier to maintain your whites first and then go fill them back in later if you need to, than to not leave yourself enough white, because you won't be able to get it back very easily. And now for these background trees, I want them generally to have the same shape as the foreground trees. So kind of these upwardly angled branches, but I'm making these a lot darker and I'm making them a lot more solid. So I'm not leaving any white spaces in between the branches or anything like that. And then this darker color is also going to help frame in the subjects of this painting as well. And right now you can see that this is actually helping the mom to stand out a little bit more against the background. So I'm just going to continue on filling in these background trees. And generally, I'm going to put the trees that are more in the midground, they're going to be a little bit darker and bolder. And then if I need to fill in more space with other trees, I'll make them a little bit lighter in value so that we get a little bit of variation back there and it's not just one big block. But really, I'm kind of just thinking of these background trees as kind of giving a little bit of texture and context to this overall composition. So I'm not putting a lot of emphasis on those. And now I'm going to be using my sepia to very lightly start painting in the branches. And I'm using very, very loose brush strokes. I'm letting the brush kind of skip around in there. I'm not looking to make any kind of solid lines. Basically, I'm trying to think of these branches as, you know, some of them are kind of peeking through and showing, and then others are going to be more hidden. And so again, I'm only going to do this on these two trees that are more in the foreground. The background trees won't have any of this detail. And this just adds a little bit of warmth as well to these trees that are more in the foreground. And now I'm just looking for different places to kind of fill in. And I'm trying to think of, you know, what color ultimately I want their clothes, because obviously I don't want their clothes just to be, you know, either Payne's gray or red. But I'm going to start out with basically using Payne's gray as a base layer, like on the pants of both the mom and the daughter. But then on the pants of the mom, I'll glaze in a little bit of red on top. And then on the little girl's pants, I'm going to glaze in some Hansa yellow to make her pants look a little bit more green. But because I used Payne's gray as kind of a base layer for those things, we're going to get some really good color harmony. And then just kind of making their hair the same color as my hair and my daughter's hair. So she has pretty light blonde hair, or at least she did back then. It's darkened a little bit. And then my hair is just a little bit darker blonde or light brunette, something, not sure. Okay, so now I'm going to use a lot of really bright, bold yellow to glaze over some of the Payne's gray that's on these foreground trees to give them a little bit more of a green look. So everywhere that I put Payne's Gray on those trees, I'm just going to glaze with some of that Hansa yellow. And you can see that that gives kind of a nice subdued green look. Especially on this shorter tree, it still has just way too much white space, but not worried about that right now. As I said, I left myself more white than I necessarily needed because it's easier to go back in than to wish I had left more white. And then I'm just adding a little bit more definition to the mom's coat, which is, again, going to make her kind of blend into the background a little bit too much. And now I'm going in with this Payne's Gray very light and just kind of filling in some of that white space. So I'm leaving enough so that those trees really stand out against the background, but I don't want that white to be so stark because the trees don't necessarily have snow on them. This is basically a scenario where it has snowed and they're at, you know, like a tree farm picking out their trees. So the snow isn't necessarily sitting on the trees any longer. And then same thing over on the tree on the left. I'm just using the Payne's Gray very, very light to fill in some of that stark white. And because the shorter tree is more the focal point than this tree, I'll actually leave even less white on this tree on the left so it can blend in just a little bit more. And that will make the shorter tree stand out a little bit more in comparison. And now I just put a little bit of red onto the pants of the mom. It was so fast, you may have not seen it. And then I'm adding a little bit of definition here to the little girl's coat with a little bit of Payne's Gray. And you can see at some point I must have already put the yellow on her pants because her pants are now green. And then I'm going in with more sepia. And on this short tree, I just felt like some of these branches needed to show a little bit stronger. So I'm just adding a few loose strokes to the tree. Again, not really, you know, following the lines exactly. I'm kind of letting it skip around and show through in some places and then not in other places. And now I am thinking of something I want to do that's a little bit different. As I said, I did a lot of experimenting with techniques in this composition in particular. So I decided that for those background trees, I wanted to see what they would look like if I glazed a little bit of red over them. So that's why I painted that tree onto that scrap paper. I'm going to let that dry so I can kind of experiment with that. And now over there on the left, I have some white India ink. I just got this. I actually bought myself some watercolor supplies that I'm very new to, well, and ink supplies. And that's kind of my Christmas present to myself, so I think I'll probably make a video just kind of introducing some of these materials, but this is the first time I've ever used white ink, and I'm kind of just using it on top of her coat just to make it a little bit grayer, because I was kind of thinking of this pea coat that I used to have, and it was just like a nice light gray color, and that's really what I wanted in this picture, so this is kind of helping me to achieve that, and now she stands out much better against the background. And that's the only thing I used this white ink for in this composition. I think what I needed to do was shake it, because when I first started using it, it was a little more transparent than I think it's really supposed to be, and it didn't shake the bottle, so that might be an issue. And then I'm just going in with a little more Payne's Gray to add in some of the definition that I lost when I added the white ink. Then adding a little more definition to the little girl. Kind of just fidgeting with things at this point. And now my little sample tree is done, so I'm just glazing in some red over that. And I decided that I like it, so I'm going to go ahead and glaze some red over these background trees as well. It's a very subtle effect, but I think that it kind of helps make this composition look a little bit less monochromatic. And now I'm going to actually mix some Payne's Gray with my Hansa yellow so I can get a really strong kind of muted green. And then I'm just going to go back into the trees that are in the foreground and add just a little bit more of this kind of green color. so that they stand out even more. Just kind of following the strokes that are already there, filling in some of the white space that is still left. Of course, I am still going to leave some of it in there, just to have a little contrast between these trees and the background trees. And we are just about finished with this piece, but there's one more little experiment that I did with this composition. So, done with the painting portion for now, and there's just one last thing that I'm going to do, which I've never done this before, and it actually turned out pretty cool. So, the ends of these brushes happen to have like a little edge on them, and so I'm actually scraping in some very light branches just with the edge of the brush, and that wasn't quite strong enough, so I ended up grabbing my box cutter and scraping in some texture into these background trees, and I really liked how that turned out. It's a little weird using a big box cutter on my little watercolor illustration, but I really like the effect that I got, and I'm probably going to do this a lot in the future. So I really, really liked how that turned out. And I was able to actually scrape pretty hard, harder than I expected to need to. And that is it for this illustration. So I'm just going to remove the tape and I'll give you a little bit of a close-up of how this looks. So I think that this actually turned out pretty good. I know you can't see much of the mom, but that's okay because it's really all about this little girl and her picking out the perfect Christmas tree that she can put the topper on all by herself. And yeah, I really liked doing this little painting. This has been really fun. I hope that you guys are enjoying these little videos. I hope that you'll subscribe, give me a like if you might, and thank you so much for watching.